struggle that goes along. There has to be a connectivity. The society can only exist by establishing the connections between the dreams, hopes, and the aspirations. And if you take away that the large chunk of the children who are dreaming and the students who are dreaming, then that hope cannot be just simply survived by in isolation. And this is what the system wants us to do. This is what the system wants us to do. Always telling that, we tell our parents tell us, our society is trained to think that way, that my child is a good boy or a girl, and they would not go into fight in the streets, and they are trained to be good people. And then all teachers say, you have to be a good student. What is a good student? Can you define about good student? When 35 to 40% of my people are hungry, poor, and malnourished, and then when you find about 250,000 farmers commit suicide. In Sri Lanka, we are talking about genocide, and more than about 140,000 people, and then 150,000 people have disappeared. We refer that as a genocide. In India, from 1990, there is a kind of 250,000 people have committed suicide who are farmers. Did we speak about it? Which university in this country stood up and said, and researchers have spoken, and which research scholars have spoken, it's been published in Hindu, and many outstanding minds have expressed about it. What more we did? What did we else say in this country by saying about 250,000 in Guatemala in 1950s and 60s people have disappeared? And in a population of 1 million and 100,000 people perished, and they have recovered the records of this thing. I went to Guatemala as part of the human rights work, and they pulled out the records of 100,000 people. They are asking the establishment, please give us information, apologize for what you did in 1960s and 70s for all the people who have disappeared. In Argentina, in Chile, and then in all these countries, who are these people who have disappeared? They are all young people like you who are sitting in this room. They are all the young, if you have read about a small review of what they call Little Passions, which talks about when you become 12-year-old, you are picked up either to join the army in Colombia in the 1970s. They wait for you to become 12. When the state waits for you to become 12 to fight for the cause, and how long should you wait to raise consciousness of the civil society and political societies? Should you wait for about you to become little later? This is the natural process of consciousness. It's kind of evolving consciousness. The philosophers would agree, and then the scientists would agree, the biologists would agree. This is a very natural concoction of your evolving consciousness, of understanding with the environment, the global realities, human realities. And you can be dispassionate, you can be indifferent, you can be quite this thing, but yet it affects you. But how you articulate is what makes you about a political citizen, or how you participate in this process. But what is this kind of response, is the code of conduct? And now, another concern is that which says about the man by the security guards, and then about CCTV cameras, and then register unknown entrants and visitors and proofs, and then including the barbed wire concerts, and then biometric way of marking students' attendance, and then the many other issues are this thing. And all this is fine. All this is fine. But you cannot have this in isolation. You can't have a community being watched. You can't bring about one community under watch unless it is about this is the a process of completely bringing, it is about not under watch alone, bringing them under control. And then you are relating that with a political society, and then addressing them with what you call, what in another sense, which is referred as on the one hand, you are talking about depoliticization and a political campus environment. on another hand, you are talking about bringing about all these devices, technology devices, and then like, you know, monitoring devices. And then, this is like, you know, at one point of time, and with all respects, I have no intention to kind of undermine the, one of our former Prime Minister said in, about the issue of the poverty, and there's a new transition took place in 1984, and in 87 he said, we must use technology to cure poverty in India. Which is quite right. You can use technology to remove and eliminate poverty, but technology can only be one part of the elimination. Unless you talk about the cleansing the system. Our system, our failure is not about lack of technology. It is about the lack of an appropriate system, which there is, where there is accountability, where there is about, like, you know, where there is a transparency. We lack transparency. Why don't we admit this fact? We lack about, like, you know, honesty in public life. We don't have a system that is accountable to the people. So without raising this question, how can you monitor people and saying that, like, why do you need that more and more control is that when there is a lack of transparency? When there is a lack of transparency, you're bringing about more devices, more gadgets. And then about, like, do we ask about, like, you know, how many teachers go to classes, to take classes in schools in this country? We never ask this question. And then about, like, you know, why do children from the government school, like, you know, why children don't go to government schools? And then about, like, you know, why they go to private school? I find about the best teachers are in government school. I can stand by and I can completely stand by and proudly say that. The best teachers are in government school. And then the best doctors, I come from a town called Vellore, and then the best doctors were there in CMC about 20 years back. But they are all in corporate and public, big hospitals in Chennai and metropolitan places where the fee is between 3,000 what you charge for a process today, and then now you are charging about some 300,000. So, like, you know, this kind of corporate culture, into academics, into medicine, into food, and then, like, this whole, this from the liberalization ethos, the globalization model, and there is this new education policy, it cannot be separated from new economic policy. Whatever the stringent measures that you want to adopt to enforce the new economic policy is the soft glove with an iron hand. It's a soft glove with an iron hand. I can stand by that. I can tell you with a reference of, like, the what they call Industrial Amendment of the Industrial Act, Government of India, 1947. They amended it by saying, it happened in 2003, and it is such a tactical measure. And when they said, we have to protect the rights of the labor in the industry. And then about, like, you know, when you call an industry, 1,000 and more people are employed in a place, and you call that as an industry. Then with that amendment, the government itself gave a leverage to the corporates and saying, you can employ 999 people, have them on roll, and not call that as an industry, and you need not abide by the laws of the labor laws. And this is a complete betrayal of the human rights. Not simply the labor rights. Now, you want this new education policy also to go in line with the new economic policy. And that's why we are taking this to the GATS now. We are signing and we are taking to this GATS, and then it will become obligation. It will become an obligation. Once it becomes an obligation, obligation is not for the ruling elites in this country. Obligation is only for the poor people and the ordinary people. And not for the ruling elites, in terms of, they have always had, they would continue to have the privileges and then the best of the perks, everything that they had had, and they would continue to have. But who has to pay for that in terms, like, how our public institutions, like hospitals, how our public schools, like government schools, have over the years have lost their significance, have kind of allowed the best teachers to move and migrate to other places. It will also happen to our educational institutions in the country, in higher educations. And then it is going to happen in higher education. Once you are going to have this kind of, when we sign in the GATS, when we sign about, like, other in tandem with the new economic policy, our obligations would stretch, kind of bringing about structural reforms. Now, this structural reform requires this control devices and regulatory process. And this is to be challenged. But what is my surprise is that, how such a thing could have come without being debated. This is the curious issue about, how can such a policy, when you are talking about, bringing about the safety and security and study, is that it is actually it's a cosmetic words. They're very cosmetic. And the intention, the actual drive inside is that it is the regulation. And another important one question that I want to place before the audience is that this is a system crisis. This includes about due to lack of transparency and lack of, absolutely there's no accountability in our education system. In our education system, accountability is that whether in a school education or in a higher education system. And then what is this accountability and systems crisis is that, I want to touch upon the issues in Madras University as well. Besides talking about the guidelines issue. Now, in Madras University, we were issued a circular. The circular was sent to the students. And this is almost the same everywhere. And this has not happened in isolation. Which says about political activity of any form inside the campuses is punishable. And then students shall not indulge in demonstrations and strikes. And then in non-academic association or organization, students are banned from joining. Students are not permitted to give press and media release without the prior permission of the authorities. But this, just the four issues I want to say about the political activity is that in Tamil Nadu, for the last 2 years, there has been an intense anti-liquor movement. And this anti-liquor movement, and this is based on the ground reality of how deeply the society has fallen, virtually crumbled. The civil society in Tamil Nadu is crumbling. And it's in a very dire state in terms of, the government says 28,000 crores profit we are receiving. And the income that we are receiving, and don't preach morality to the state. And so we are not supposed to preach morality to the state, but the state says that, they keep saying 28,000 crores is an income. No, but this, if you go by the family to family, individual to individual, almost every family and every village and town is affected. But the government is not considering in 20 years' time, who's going to pay the health bill, and in terms of the hospital and medicine, and where will that money come from? And this government, they are doing the populist measures that's distributing freebies to the people from this revenue and running this populist administration. And this applies to all the parties. I'm not holding any one party or the other. Now, at the end of this thing, when you raise this question, when you raise about the liquor policy should be reviewed, and we are saying about whether prohibition should be complete or not, debatable. And then in terms of, but it should be reviewed, why is it that the government is upfront? Why is it that the government says you should not protest? And one of the television person asked me about while we were in the middle of this protest, and they asked me through this conversation, we understand there's a protest going on, but why is it? It is so political. We have reasons to believe that it is political. And then I asked them back, what do you mean that you are saying it is, you have reasons to believe it is political? It is political. When being corrupt is not political, and being about not being accountable is normal, and to question that is political. What kind of political education that we are suffering in this country? To question a system which is corrupt, which is not accountable, and which is undemocratic, and that is normal. But to, when you question that, you are being supported by political parties, you are being supported by the left, you are being supported by other forces. And then why all these things, we ourselves, being conscious, cannot be branded as political. That is, just being political is normal. And because you are a citizen, they've given you the right about, like, you know, anything that can make you feel good about living in a country is that you must feel that I'm a citizen of this country. And if you are a citizen of this country, if that is not political, what else is political for you to go through in life? That amazes me, that question. Then when I shot them back, they said, like, fine, we understand that. Another thing is that students shall not indulge in demonstrations and strikes, and then not give press and meet, press meet. This violates the fundamental right. I mean, this particular circular, if you take it to the court, and it can just completely violate the book. If the government of India, or if Mrs. Gandhi had issued this in 1974, or like, you know, the present government issues this signed by the appropriate authority, and this can go against the constitution. But when a university issues it, and we don't think that it goes against the constitution, because we are trained to think that when the authorities send you the circular, everything is legal. Everything is legal. But it is not sometimes what is legal may not be constitutional. You have to understand, because they create the substructure is the gift of the British colonialism. You make a law, if that law doesn't work, you kind of amend that law and put a clause A, clause B to it and push the policy. That's called as an executive order. The British have done that. That is what our administrations keep doing. When the law is not, when you don't have the legal right to do it, you create an executive right. You create an executive right and violate the constitution. This goes against the spirit and letter of the constitution of India. And our students in Madras University, when they were asked in the inquiry committee about their, they said, you have to obey the code of conduct of the University of Madras. And all majority of my students said, I'm here to obey the constitution of India. They said, what do you mean you are here to obey the constitution of India? You are supposed to obey the code and conduct of the University of Madras. My students asked them, like, is your code of conduct is within the constitution of India or not? Nobody could open their mouth. Nobody could open their mouth, but no one accepted that as a reasonable answer. And that is the level of our university rights and the university system. I mean, I must say that kind of this, the oppression we have faced, I mean, this is beside the point. You may think about, like, you know, I was asked to step down. I was asked to step down because I refused to divulge information about my students. And then about, like, you know, I was kept in as the head, in charge for 3.5 years. And like 3.5 years, and then about, like, you know, why this 3.5 years ended now is that, like, you know, why didn't you, they could have made me as a head long time back. They said, I was the only person in the entire University of Madras as professor kept in charge. The reason they said is that he is political. And, but I am afraid that, like, you know, why do you keep somebody? I mean, like, you know, this completely demolishes about, like, it's an anti-constitutional statement. And when you say one person is political, and if you take away others' right to this thing, does it, is that I only have the right to vote in this country or in the University of Madras? No one else. Everyone has a right to vote. And then, this is the oppression is that it is such a systemic oppression. There is a very, when I was, I every day I read one of either Martin Luther King or about, like, Nelson Mandela, Albert Lutley, or about, like, you know, people who are in the ground struggle every day, or Gandhi, like, you know, in the life of the struggle every day is that you will find that not a day is different to one another in the world. It's only the change of time, day, and people change. The nature of oppression towards transformative politics is all the same. There's a very beautiful statement made by Martin Luther King in 1962. He says that, like, you know, that everything Adolf Hitler did in Germany was legal. and like, you know, but then legal instead, you create the law in that way. You create the structure in that way. Then you call it as legal. But then, if I were there in that place, I would have disobeyed that law, which is against God and against humanity. Any law that is against God and humanity cannot be law at all. This is the same thing Nelson Mandela said in his defense. This is the same, the turning point in the legal profession of Gandhi is that, like, you know, when he said, I am very happy to disobey the law that you are telling me that is legal. That transformed not only the Gandhi, but the judiciary, the judge who delivered that verdict. And why I am mentioning is that, like, whatever the construction of legal in this, there is no kind of constitution, there is no kind of a moral. And then, this kind of idea of biases is that it is wrong. IIT is a biases among all educational institutions. That is wrong. And then all educational institutions are biases in our society. That's also wrong. And then about, like, you know, this kind of building elite suprastructures. And these becomes, like, you know, who gets aloof and isolated is that people move away from IIT. And people in IIT move away from people. People in educational institutions, people in medical institutions. This is one of the reasons that why our doctors don't want to go to villages in India. Our doctors don't want to go to villages. The only reason they ask is that after paying so much of money for getting a seat in this country, you think I can recover that money in going to a village? What a shame. Not on the doctors, on the system. And, like, you know, in other countries, like, you know, this is the core of systemic failure is that the corruption. The corruption is that's very important. Like, you know, you can't say that corruption is, like, you know, everyone is corrupt. The system is corrupt. Like, how am I going to change? Why should I be part of this change? You need to be part of this awareness. When you don't get water, it is because of corruption. Somebody takes away the money that is due for water. And when you don't get a road, that money is due for the road is being taken away by someone. And then when you don't get the basic infrastructure, that is corruption. Then about, like, you know, when this last 50 years in Tamil Nadu, in all the vice chancellor are appointed is that, like, you know, they come from the political parties. They are not only loyalists, excepting distinguished few, with all respects, which I behold. But rest all, like, you know, the political loyalties, and then, like, you know, they want to subordinate the universities much more than the political parties expect them to do it. Like, you know, when you are, I mean, this is a direct attack on the education when you are appointing vice-chancellors who are not academic. I mean, our vice-chancellor has given about 75 PhDs in his career. Let me ask you this, in IIT, you are a much learned institution. Can any professor can write 75 theses in a lifetime? Why is it not being challenged in Tamil Nadu? Why nobody has dared to ask this question to the political parties? And then, like, you know, it's a depoliticization. When you ask that question, it is politicization. That when you make that mistake, it is depoliticization, where you're killing the civil society. You're kind of, like, you know, take away the consciousness, eliminate the seeds of consciousness. Then you want just that, a complete bed of roses that doesn't smell. It's kind of like, you know, no fragrance, no stimulation. It's kind of it's a kind of a funeral bedrock. So that's the kind of education. You have to have universities, educational institutions, vibrant, and then active and articulate. If you don't have these activities, then the societies, like, if all societies have to go and ask for permission, with so many different layers of permission, if you have to ask, and no society could come into existence. I mean, like, you know, we ran a student parliament in the University of Madras for the last 3.5-4 years. We were running that, and we discussed about every bill in the parliament. Most of the bills, like, you know, whether it is a Telangana, even before the Telangana bill was passed in the legislature, we debated, our students debated it. And if it is about the food rights, and if it is about the labor, and if it's about foreign policy, and any issues that, now, that's kind of political education. We need to have that education. This can happen in different ways, in different places, throughout the country, in all educational institutions. And if we don't have this, then what happens is that there is always a very conscious student who is passing out asking this question, and I wish I had known this. The person who is saying this could have been the source of transformation. And even one person makes a difference in protecting a life, like very beautifully said, if you save one life, you save humanity. And one life, if you save humanity. And this arises needs in about like human rights defense, human rights articulation, political rights. And if we don't speak for the rights of people in northeastern part of India, who's going to speak? Can they speak there by sitting there and there with the Armed Forces Act? Can they speak for themselves? And like, you know, when you want about Kashmir to be in the map of India, should we not speak about the democratic process in Kashmir? And should we not talk about the oppressed people in all parts of the country, everywhere? Then if students don't speak, and who will speak? Should political parties speak? Political parties, let me tell you one thing, and they trade rights. Virtually, they trade rights for politics. And if, I mean, like, you know, that's the kind of what they call a step-by-step approach to kind of complete redressal, is that this society will not exist by the time that you go through that kind of process, a process change thing, and the changes that should come forth. That when the recognition is possible. The land rights debate, the land rights question that is going on today is that the Congress party says that, you know, we will not allow an inch of land to be taken away from the people. But then they took away in acres when they were in power. And this is between them, they trade from one to another. But on the other hand, it is the common people who has to keep this consciousness alive. So like, then, in all this that I want to share, one concern to you is that in such a gloomy picture of this higher education institutes and the guidelines and things, it should be challenged, it should be questioned, it should be debated. There's no doubt about that question. Then the issue of code of conduct, we must ask a question, what is the right code of conduct? We never ask in our education, what is the right education? We don't ask about our education policy. What is the right education? Like, you know, when I'm not here to question about, like, I respect Dhirubhai Ambani for their efforts. But when you have only, like, you know, the Anil Ambani guiding the education policy, when you have the corporate capitalist guiding that education policy, but when have you ever seen before the finance ministry drafts the budget plan, the farmers in this country being consulted? But why that industrialists alone are consulted in before that every year budget? You are down in the middle of a budget session. You are in October. Please wait and see. In the month of February, all the captains of the industry will be called, either in Delhi, Bombay, Calcutta, Chennai, Bangalore. But has anyone, the Prime Minister, or the agriculture minister, or the finance minister, met farmers and asked them, please tell us your grievances? But like, you know, why no one even accounted that, you know, where did this 250,000 farmers have gone in this country? So like, you know, I'm kind of like, you know, this new economic policy, new education policy, and then going in this drive about like in this process is that we've kind of like, you know, this imagination of a caged society. And there is an ideological spectrum too. There is an ideological spectrum. Like, if you ask me about like, I take pride in whatever identity that I am. But I take pride in India for one identity, that is, India is a diverse, secular nation. India is, it's one of the most creative imagination of this country is that most inspiring concept of India is that otherwise this concept of India cannot survive. And for me, the idea of India is not political, it is a cultural concept. This cultural concept, if you cut the branches of this cultural tree, the idea and imagination of India cannot survive. And if you go by the numerical concept of majority and minority in this whole tree, that like, you know, you cannot count the leaves in tree as saying which is larger in number, which is less in number, and say, this are the greater number shall prevail. That's not the way a society can thrive. and it will be like, you know, cutting at the bottom and the root of this tree itself. And another important concern is that in all these difficult times, there is something like, you know, this in 2005, there was a committee report, the Central Advisory Board of Education, Committee on Autonomy of Higher Education. None of our universities talk about this autonomy of education. These reports are all buried. I mean, I pulled this from, I did some search and then went searched back down the years to pull this document. And then this document says, like, you know, for us, accountability is, autonomy in university is as important as accountability. This is a very beautiful expression which said about autonomy of higher education is a prerequisite for enabling the students to achieve the goals and objectives. This autonomy won't come with gadgets and devices and the high wall rises and closer of the debate and discussion, or like, you know, closer of the political culture. And then autonomy goes hand in hand with accountability. This charter of responsibility, which includes devolution and delegation of authority. And many of our universities, and we don't understand what is devolution or delegation of authority. We delegate primarily that power, and then we delegate the authority, not the power. And another important thing is that I'm a teacher in political science, and I've been trying to understand what is decentralization. I understood it in the month of August and September, when they decentralized the oppression. In a, such a decentralized way, the oppression was established in the University of Madras. Like, not even the power is shared. And how they distributed the channel of oppression is that they gave the power to the heads of departments. This is decentralization for our administration. And they ask you for decentralization is in terms of the good governance and being accountable to people. And decentralization means listen to the ground. That's the real word for expression of listening to the ground. But here, from on top of the system, you monitor by establishing. And I really, I mean, I can say this to you. I like, you know, I'm conscious about the abuse of rights and throughout my life. And then, like, you know, anything that goes through about, I never experienced that kind of oppression. And in the university system, like the way we experienced in the last 2 months in Madras University. Last 6 months, police has been there with uniform, and about 50 of them, and then about 20 of them without uniform. Then there is intelligence bureau, IB, personnel inside the police. Then there are thugs without any uniform. Hired goons inside the university. And this is for our democratic rights. And like, you know, I can identify this, but, you know, where do we go and tell in the system? How can we, who will believe us that there are about like hired goons inside the university, this thing? This is the kind of political system, with times that we are living in. And in this, in these circumstances, we must speak about autonomy. But we also understand responsibility. We also understand about accountability. And this autonomy in education, and like, you know, if you are talking about autonomy is like, you know, complements the kind of creative consciousness, creativity. And then, like, you know, we do not understand rights without responsibilities. I also want to make this. And if you believe the students are not going to be responsible, then we do not understand the society. It's simply we don't understand, we don't take responsibility for our own children if we keep undermining their sense of responsibility, their sense of future and commitment for transformation. And I think about, like, you know, these are the broader issue that I wanted to touch. If there's anything that I have missed and we could bring it up, it need not be one-way response. Thank you very much.
But India has virtually no law on electronic surveillance. With the implication that the state can do anything it likes, because there isn't even law over which the state can be held to account in the courts. In other places, the dirty work is in the legislative drafting. The British Regulation of Investigative Powers Act 2000 allows for very large amounts of electronic surveillance and record keeping without judicial warrant. Right? So the dirty work is in the legislative drafting. But if we didn't read the drafting debates or didn't read the white papers when these were circulated, we wouldn't know that. Yeah? That's why I'd say, you know, what Ravi said as well, pay attention to the system. That ordinance that came down from UPC might well have been unconstitutional. Yeah.
Actually, the recent circular regarding storing your WhatsApp messages and your mistakes, that has been recalled, but otherwise that would have been another example of decentralization as you pointed out. We decentralize even record keeping. That we keep your own records. You stick in call at any point of time. But it's been recorded.
Any other questions? This one here. I think we can hear, no problem.
Yes. So I just wanted to play a bit of the devil's advocate here. Okay, because there's a tendency to assume that student politics is always progressive. But also student politics in India, especially in the recent times, has been at its best very regressive. For instance, we have seen the youth for equality. We have seen IIT Delhi students coming out and sweeping streets and protest against reservations. Okay, we've also seen like the entire Modi campaign. You know, the students form a bulk of it. There are lots of places where you have the IITs for Modi or things like that. So why do you assume the students also have a class and they also fit into a certain kind of a class structure at a back?
Okay. So why don't we look at it about, like, you know, this is all the different perspectives in the society. I'm not taking per se that the entire student community is going to speak. I mean, we are simply the samples in the civil society. And like, you know, we behave and then conduct ourselves in the same way as the society does. And then we cannot be quite different to the thing. But at the same time, like, there is a sense of justice. And like, you know, like where you find, and among the students in levels as in the universities and colleges and then about like institutions, the sense of justice, you could speak to each other and like debate. That justice should prevail. That's what we are saying. We are not saying that go run a campaign. And then what, like, you know, if it has to happen in larger scale, that also cannot prevail unless and until there is a broader consensus for a progressive transformation. And like you find about, there is another situation like where there is a tremendous repression of students or the larger civil society, and the students speak for the civil society. Where in different political situations in many countries, and even in the last 2 years or 2 to 3 years, where the entire civil society in Sri Lanka has been, the north and east, the civil society has been silent. Jaffna University has spoken in different places. Then about, like, you know, in 1950s and mid-50s and early 60s, that the universities in the west had spoken about, that they go through this conversion. They struggle it out, fight it out, talk among each other. Then they let an idea to emerge. And like what happened in the 1990s, the third wave movement in European countries, is the long line of the result of the 1960s movement that happened. And like the Greens and the anti-nuclear, they kind of like, you know, fighting it out and sorting out issues. That's the democratic process. And the ideas and contradicting notions of what change should be, and progressive, regressive ethos, and when there's a case about, like, you know, the Shabanu case. And Shabanu case is like, you know, the government was, the society, civil society was progressive. The government said that, like, you know, we'll back the establishment. That's a very interesting trend, that civil society was more progressive, that usually the governments wait for a progressive transformation to occur and say, we'll catch this threat and bring about a change. And in such certain situations, and civil society or, like, you know, independent groups are far more progressive. Even governments at times cannot comprehend that kind of progressiveness. And this kind of, like, you know, the shades are there. I'm not at all undermining state. And then whatever we are saying, other person has a right to that position. We cannot take away that right.
Yeah. Professor Ram, I want to admire your courage in your university, and also want to say I liked your talk very much.
Okay.
But wanted to add a few things.
Sure. Yes.
The first is that the introduction of police and biometric card and so on is a lesser evil than the evil that we have committed to our universities. For example, the guys who are sitting at the top and saying you have to introduce biometric card and police stations in the universities and all are actually the products of our own university creations. We were always in chains. We always created IIT-like structures that were already always on place. Given the chance, my middle class students and my middle class colleagues will get into enclaves and shut themselves out from society. And they do, and in the educational institutions. Classroom, in my opinion, is the best place for doing politics. Just because you gather a few hundred students and demonstrate outside, it doesn't mean they are politically liberated minds. They can't be manipulated by left and right politics, which have always happened in our Indian universities. So we need not romanticize. I'm not saying you are romanticizing.
No, no.
Yeah. We need not romanticize political demonstrations. What we need is a liberated education system where universities are actually not metaphorically enclaves. In principle, I'm still not against police and other things which are lesser evil, in my opinion.
I appreciate your observations. And let me say by first thing about what we call is biometric and as well as kind of regulatory mechanisms. And see, at the outset, it's a lesser evil. I understand and respect about what you're saying. And it's maybe probably we have drawn ourselves into a situation like this. And since Arvind has gave a reference about the British universities, in American universities, every American university is under the scan of a police station or a police body inside. And may I say that enormous violence, the sexual violence and abuses have been going on, and which they have not even revealed for many, many years, and then until about they are now saying, American civil political administration and academic administration is very reluctant to admit there is a lot of sexual violence and violence against women inside the campus. This is besides the presence of a police force. And I'm not countering this argument. I'm saying about is that a solution? That's what we are talking about. And another situation is the gadgets and then other, the technology that is used for, can you monitor the society by a consciousness, by technology? And by what you call is biometric, and if you bring that as a kind of, it can regulate, and it can regulate kind of, it can draw, and what we are afraid is that it can draw into an obedience to the system, then the protecting the measures. And people who want to violate, they can always violate by placing the biometric and step out and then not be here. And this is one other aspect. I mean, let me not go into detail of that. Another thing is while you respect about politics in the classroom, is that politics is there everywhere. Why only in classroom?
No, I did not mean it that way.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, then another fact is that this kind of demonstrations is that when you say but unless you articulate the aspiration, how do we articulate? We can write, we can speak in public places. And then about in 65 years in Indian independence, and then about the last
in the 65 years and 157 years of Madras University existence is that, and should I, how many letters should I write for a glass of water? You tell me. How many letters should I write for a glass of water? And then about like, you know, not only for me, and then for how many, I mean, I'm not at all romanticizing. And if I met people who are victims of human rights violence, people who have taken up about in struggle, and then I asked them, why do you need to go fight by taking a gun? Why don't you just kind of like, you know, be a non-violent in this thing? And like, you know, they say about like, you know, we have done everything. And even this is for the armed violence people, but in demonstration, is a demonstration is a rightful political expression. We don't have to undermine that. And then about like, you know, it's a very rightful democratic expression. And then another factor is that, like, you know, unless you kind of draw the attention, and if Gandhi, for when he was thrown out of the train and in Pietermaritzburg, and like, you know, if Gandhi had thought that, like, you know, if I'm thrown out and let me not get into the coach, and then about like, you know, and one of my teachers said, he said to me it's a fascinating thing what you're saying, that's why I'm sharing it. I'm not answering your question, I'm discussing with you. And what happened is that one of my teachers said, if Gandhi was not thrown out of the train, you would not have had the freedom of India. And I said, no, I don't agree with that. Because that there would have been millions of Gandhis who were thrown out of train everywhere. But it takes one man to steer that and say that, like, you know, come around, let's fight it out. Somebody somewhere has to do that work. And that, like, you know, that is not sin at all. That is not wrong at all. And then about, like, you know, this romanticization, where does it take place is that, like, you know, if we see that in terms of, if we are glorifying it without resistance, that is romanticization. But like, you know, if we are kind of fighting it, we are fighting for it, and there is about, we have filed a case in the court. If we go to the court, then we don't have to demonstrate. May I ask about, has the university provided water to us? Not at all. It is a contempt of court. But when they dare to do this, when they dare to do this way in a system, what does it show is that the system is, not only system is powerful, and the kind of depoliticization that has happened is that we are numb in our society. And finally, look at our politicians today. Like, you know, they are paying money to the people and asking people to vote for them. That's the kind of depoliticization we are. It's a social necessity sometimes. We have to fight.
Sir,
yeah.
I have a question. Why should we always be anxious about the political party? We are
Sure. So surely
like as young minds we need to get exposure to the left or right, like whichever political parties are existing, and we should choose if I want to be a part of left or if I want to be part of right, and if I want to like be part of that political party and bring some changes in the country, because they are ruling the country.
Sure.
If they want to be part of it and be a ruler, like why should we be suspicious about
it? We are not suspicious. We are critical. We are not suspicious at all. We know them what they are. But why should there be only few parties?
Yeah, there can be.
We can also play a role. Civil society has a very big role in politics. And if civil society is not conscious, if we don't raise this question, and then about like, you know, nobody will speak, we will have to think we are in the process of conscientizing. And we are part of the conscientizing the political parties. And they don't kind of like, you know, we don't have to plead with them. We can question them. We can challenge them. We can be critical of them. That's also part of the democratic discourse. We are also afraid of them. Because of like, you know, the excessive power and authority that they have consummated over these years. And like, you know, it is like the creation taking over the creator. And so we need to challenge the political parties. We are not suspicious. We know they are who they are, what they are. So we have to challenge them.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. You were saying that something is less significant or there's a technological surveillance or something like that. But I think not only this, we can't just like that.
talking about the tenure system in US. Here also, in IIT, after the recommendation of the committee, they were the newly appointed faculties are in the tenure, I think,
yes.
7 years or something. So those who are coming to this fraternity can't speak, because in the end of the tenure, if they are going for a review, there they will be raised about these questions by the authorities. So the actual switch is there.
Yeah, it's a threat. Surveillance is a threat. Fundamentally, it's about a threat, actually. There's no.
We can't just like that neglect all this kind of surveillance.
I also wanted to add to or respond to Rajendran's point. I mean, I don't regard police station as a capital as a lesser evil at all. I mean, I think that is disastrous, because it would be actually internalizing the evidence. And that is one thing. But I also feel, with all due respect, that we very, very, I think, carelessly use the word romantic in the negative sense. I think the word romantic is a far more important word than realized, and while not romanticizing, I think we need to understand the romantic connotations of evolution itself, first of all, but that's a different issue. I do feel that the classroom as a political space, as a place to have a political dialogue is excellent, and always. I mean, I remember one of the wonderful directors of the DAD giving a lecture inside IIT campus and saying, I said, auditorium, that to professors of IIT, that teaching is, you are engaged in one of the most subversive activities of all human candidates. So that is the political potential of the classroom situation. But at the same time, I think while it's a thin line, now that I am faculty advising the APSC, I know from first hand, it's a very thin line to negotiate between allowing a party politics to enter a campus while maintaining that each and every student on the campus have a political awareness. They might have party affiliations, and I think that's entirely because the adults are free to have that. But I'm not sure that it's so wrong to go on demonstrations while, as a student, probably most of us of faculty here have as students gone on demonstration. But I'm kind of agreeing with him that it's a very thin line to walk as to how far you can go in allowing political activism on campus.
As far as my knowledge, the common people are not even reading the newspapers. Only we have the time to analyze things, read things, and we are only the fraternity who have access to this kind of resources. Even the, as we said, the bills or policies, or whatever may be the draftings or whatever may be the issues. So if we are not taking that in a propagating way, demonstration or letter or whatever it may be, then who else can do it?
I'd
like to respond to Milan.
Sure, go ahead.
Milan is correct, but slightly misunderstood me in a sense. I am for political reform within the academia. We are not yet ready for responding to this kind of surveillance technologies, because we always developed an education system which always enslaved our mind, and that's what is coming and haunting us in the first place. This kind of surveillance technologies and other things are coming to us in the first place because of the kind of people we have generated, and both left and right politics have to be blamed for that. That's what I want to say. And I still hold to it.
That's true.
Can I respond to
that?
Yeah.
To this very
perceptive of the two points that we make. Ordinary people throughout the length and breadth of India read newspapers in an enormous variety of languages. And if they don't read them, if you stop at the tea stall, somebody else is reading the paper out to them. We should be enormously grateful not only that they can do so, but that they do so. It's when they stop we should start getting really worried. But secondly, what does it say about our sense of the political that we take political simply to mean party politics? Right?
Yeah.
If I've understood him right,
yes.
He's saying our minds have been enslaved. Isn't that a colossal political condemnation? Right? Our minds have been enslaved. What does it say about us as I'm not a citizen of a republic. I'm the subject of a monarch, believe it or not. And I am constitutionally a subject, not a citizen, even though I'm called a citizen in various contexts. Right? But you're citizens, most of you here are citizens of a republic. Think of the difference. But what does it say about us that we have, our minds have been enslaved? Now, is that a political point? Might we not be raising highly political points when we challenge the systems of power and lack of accountability in higher education institutions without having anything to do with political parties? What has happened to us that we have come to associate the very idea of the political with political parties? This has happened in other parts of the world as well. So,
yeah, I think, thank you very much for this talk. I've just joined this institution very recently. I've been married for a long time to an Indian national, so I have some experience with the system, but I come from Germany and studied in Germany, partly very, very similar experience in Germany as you, like being politically very active in the university, but not in terms of party politics. And I mean, this is what we are even trying to teach our students. If I teach to one of these engineering students, to a BTEC student, you're actually politically acting as an engineer in your activity as an engineer. You're acting in society, and that is political. By definition, it's not party politics, it's political. And I think what we really need is a discourse, not only a debate, not only in India, but in general, about the role of university in society, and the political role of university in society. What we need, you're absolutely right, about autonomy, both from politics, but also from the economic system. Right? I mean, it has become such a paradigm, such an impetus, that the only need while we are here is to serve this kind of economic paradigm. If you go back in history, I'm a historian of science, this is not what universities were created for. What is the role of university in society? And what is the role of the students in society when they go out there? They have to be thinking, and this is the most important lesson I try to teach my students. And this is very, very difficult because the educational system and also the IIT system is just not made for that. You have to think for yourself. You have to be becoming a person that has to stand up for its own decisions. You have to be able not to absorb the knowledge that I gave you, but I have to enable you to be a responsible citizen, especially if you go through something like the university education. And being political is part of that. So saying we want to apoliticize students is total nonsense in that sense. We want to have students that are politically independent, also beyond party politics. Like one of these, I've just been teaching this, The Norms of Science for Robert Merton, actually written in 1942, in the midst as a reaction to what happened in Germany at that time. And one of the norms is organized skepticism, right? And that's really what we have to teach our students. So there's no way.
One sentence.
Sir, I have one question.
I don't think, who spoke?
Suramya.
When Suramya asked the question, I don't think it is equating politics with party politics. But I think her drift was not to consider party politics as
the only thing.
That's what we are just clear on that.
But I didn't understand you to be saying that.
Yeah. So I have.
I'll take that question. Before this, but I want to make this reference to about the newspapers and the reading and the universe. I'll take that, definitely. You know, through this struggle in the last few years or elsewhere, that about what has really made us sad through the struggle is about the institutions and about the politics, and more sad about the academic community. Like, you know, when the decentralized, the oppression was decentralized, the executioners of this oppression were all other teachers. This is what I really want to take this to the academic community. What happened to us is that there are 40 charges against me in the University of Madras. 40 charges as a teacher, anybody can commit, is really serious concern. Except murder, all the charges are there in the Supreme Court. And then, like, you know, these charges were 27 at one point, and next week it became 40. And then I asked them, like, this is more like traveling in an auto or a taxi, that, like, you're traveling in the university, the charges go up, you know, every week. And what is this interesting thing is that one of these charges that, like, you know, we were asking for international investigations about the human rights violations in Sri Lanka. There was a protest demonstration. I was also there. And after that, we were given a memo. Then, subsequently, we were arrested by the police. Police was brought in after 25 years into the campus, and we were taken into a kind of detention, and for about 3 to 4 hours of preventive detention, were released. And when the prohibition, the Stasmark anti-liquor protest took place, and then about, like, you know, we were taken in for this protest. My students went on a demonstrative protest for about 13 days, and my colleagues, about 9 colleagues, came and asked me that, no, I want you to talk to the students to stop the protest. I said, you never spoke all these days and years anything about the students or the rights and issues about water needs. But when they are protesting, you are asking me to go and stop. They said, they are protesting because of charges against you and you have been demoted. I said, don't mistake that. Then during that time, I asked them, do you know that there are 30 charges against another colleague like you? I'm also a teacher in this university. Will not one teacher speak for me and say that, like, you know, there are 30 charges? They said, everyone in the 9 members interrogating one, me, I look like a prisoner in that place, in my own colleagues' domain. Let me tell you, I work in the human rights evidence work for more than years. I collect evidence of human rights violations. I felt like I'm in a detention camp. In front of my 9 colleagues, they asked me about it. Then I asked them, do you know that, like, you know, I was kept under preventive detention for 4 hours, then I was arrested. It came in the newspaper. I honestly say this, not a single teacher said they know. For the newspaper and awareness, and for awareness in a political society. And another colleague in the university is arrested, kept under preventive detention for 4 hours. Not a single member in the Madras University. There are friends. They, of course, knew and expressed their solidarity. But the team that kind of interrogated, asked me to go and speak to the students, protesting students, they said none of them knew about it. And then I asked them, at least you may be reading a newspaper every day. Then people said, oh, we read newspaper. Then about how come that in the newspaper that you read, you did not see anything about the detention that happened. They said about, like, and then I asked them, generally you come to teach in the university without consciousness. You prepare your reading materials and lecture materials. And the newspapers is another piece of printed matter. And it doesn't, so this is the level of consciousness in the academic community. You kind of, step by step, you numb this, that aspirations and that, like, you know, ability to question, ability to be aware, conscious. So that's very important about, like, you know, and because everyone wants to be secure. And in this security is that if everybody wants to be secure, then someone has to feel insecure to threaten, question the system. Let it be someone. And, like, you know, let that someone, allow that someone to speak. Don't betray that person. That is where the change can happen.
Is it Pandit Nehru who said in an international gathering in the 1950s, total security for everyone means total insecurity for everyone?
Yeah, there is no total security. Can I take
it? This is regarding the daily. So in the pamphlet also, actually we have pointed out in all the four institutes, including IIT, there is a set of guidelines. But if you see the guidelines, it's completely against to the Indian constitution. But I mean, all the administration is actually ready to frame their own guidelines according to their convenience. But actually, within the constitutional framework, how this actually to said so how much extent this set of guidelines are valid? For example, actually Madras University or IIT Madras.
It's totally unconstitutional about, like, you know, if you say about, like, you know, the Madras University guidelines, student guidelines, can be challenged in the court. Then about any decision that is taken for in the as part of a governing principle, that we have to ask about that the process of evolving that as a policy decision. Where does it, how does it originate? And then, like, you know, in terms of policy guidelines, then that how the decisions are made. And that kind of, like, you know, we have this RTA. And UGC can be questioned on this RTA lands. And then the information that they provide, you can take that to the court and then ask the court. And ask the court whether this kind of is consistent with the laws of the land. And then there is about, like, you know, I read this pamphlet which you're saying about 2006 and 7, this Kerala University and the High Court of Kerala, which talks about the Linga committee, also takes a threat from the Kerala verdict, High Court verdict. But at the same time, what we don't show as a precedent is that CAB, the Committee on Autonomy in the University. So you simultaneously bring that. We only show one side of the law. And, like, you know, citing the precedent is that the Kerala, the High Court of Kerala becomes the precedent for Lingdo Committee. At the same time, that when Arjun Singh was the minister for HRD and Ministry of Human Resource Development, the same time there was a committee and that has been formed, which has gone into the autonomy, gave a recommendation that without autonomy, there cannot be any kind of creativity. So that those committees disappear. Even there is a very famous report in the Planning Commission, 9th and 11th Planning Commission report, which talks about the Ramamurthy Commission, which is an excellent, which is a revolutionary document and is a Gandhian. And then we don't think revolution always means it's not left. Many of us think about revolution means, like, you know, it is left. But, like, you know, the Gandhian concept, we said, first thing when you finish school, we don't send our children to universities. That will be a revolution in our system. Because, like, you know, you're kind of, like, you know, a machine going from 12 years of school education, just going like a mechanized insect, get jump and go into the university, and then, like, there's no time for you to turn around and reflect what you've been doing, what you want in life. And then what Ramamurthy said is that, please send all our children to villages, to different parts of the country. Let them see what they want to do and ask them to come back after 1 year. Let them enroll in IIT. Let them go as medical schools, engineering schools, to be a historian, social scientist. That is the real revolution we are talking about in education system. And on the other hand, it's like, you know, when they're, what is our education system? When people are studying about the 11th standard, plus one, they are doing the syllabus of the plus two. They don't study the plus one syllabus. And in this, all the chicken farms or the broiler schools in Tamil Nadu. They're all broiler schools. And they're doing the syllabus of the, in Andhra Pradesh, the school is that they're asking, does your school have an IIT entrance exam curriculum? What is that IIT entrance exam curriculum? Is that don't study physics, chemistry and maths, and just study the question papers. And then about, like, you know, these are all the broiler institutions. And, like, which takes away and completely the process of the knowledge as an evolutionary process. And that's why Indian Institute of Science, like, you know, which said last 5 years back, the basic sciences will have to come back. And it has come back now. Basic sciences are coming back in this country. And nobody can prevent what is natural, what is the basic, the natural law of knowledge or evolution of knowledge.
Philip, I'll just say in that collection that I reviewed that elite institutions cannot redeem the failings of an entire system.
then we need to ask why the system is not only such a mess in what it imparts, but why it appears to be so far beyond public access and public accountability, why its senior staff throughout the system appear to be to have quite so much power for which they don't have to answer. I should point out this happens elsewhere. British universities are among the worst at responding to the Freedom of Information Act 1998, which covers all public institutions, and that includes former public institutions which are now providing power and gas supply. Right? Institutions like that now compete in the private sector, but they are covered by the FOI. Universities are among the worst responders to FOI requests. So these are problems that do occur elsewhere. One of the things that we might want to ask about surveillance systems on campus or any campus is who gets access to the records, how long are they kept, can we get access to them, how do we know you're not sending the information on to someone else. These issues have arisen elsewhere. They have arisen in other countries where people who collect electronic information, quite often private firms on contract to larger bodies, have been selling the information off. We used to say, if you shop in a British supermarket, don't use your card, because your card will be sold on, not the number, the details of the card and your purchases will be sold on by the supermarket, and you will then be targeted for mailing, for emailing, for advertising. It's happened to me. And then, belatedly, new regulations were brought in, codes of practice were brought in to say you shouldn't do that, and so on and so forth. You'll be familiar with privacy policies on email web pages, on web pages and so on, right? These things do arise elsewhere. We're perhaps a bit slower in asking the questions and slower in asking these questions of our public education institutions. What do you do with the records? Who has access to them? Is this within the Constitution? I've looked at proposed regulations and I thought that must violate the Constitution. And Professor Manivannan has pointed that out again and again. So any one more point anyone want to raise? Any one question, please? Just one gentleman for that.
Actually, I would like to add a point that a lot of people in India are not exposed to the system and they are not brave enough to tackle the policy. And about the surveillance, actually one of the facts in Madras you said is that when we go and mingle with other students, we actually are afraid that they may suspend us. For example, you know, when we speak about a situation against the system of what the rules and regulations, because we are not stable enough. For example, in UP, for 300 jobs, there are 255 PhD candidates applying for the course. And when we are not financially stable of our situation, we are not brave enough. Actually, lack of exposure, lack of financial stability, and that is a problem that every student is facing. So, and right guidance is also not available. Means where to contact, means contact is not there, communication problem, a lot of things are there. So, I would like to add a point saying that these are factors which is actually affecting the system. And not only it's going against the policies.
So I agree with you completely about, like, you know, this is the way to break the will of any resistance. And this is the pattern in Madras, like you said about the pattern they used in Madras University is very, very oppressive model they used in high detention and oppressive structures and systems. I'm not ashamed in using that word. That's what they did it. They used teachers to break the thing. They used students to break this thing. They did everything. And then, but what I still understand about, like, what is being political is that in any collective, resistance has to be collective. You cannot resist individually and say that, you know, I can change things, because, like, you know, you have, this is a political transformation. And like, you know, like I mentioned to you, in the spiritual world they say about, like, you know, there are millions of Buddhas, and in the political world about, like, you know, it is not one Gandhi that will just change this country. You need many more Gandhis. Similarly, about any change that you are bringing about, you must have the solidarity. And then about
collective people who kind of very vulnerable to break away, and the struggle, no struggle has survived just at one time sitting. And like, you know, if you take from any national struggles, you have the worst failure, well, unimaginable dire consequences, but you must survive, learn, come back and fight. And that fighting is always done collectively, not in isolation.
Thank you all for your patience and the acuity and sharpness of your questions.
We'd like to thank Professor Manivannan for the last point, right?
I'm a student from the University of Madras. I came the mass suspension happens in the University of Madras. I came through only through the newspaper, and what is happening in one campus in the university, we don't know what is happening here. We are from three campus, we don't know what happened in the other campus. And the day that mass suspension has happened, I felt very bad to come to the department because this is totally an authoritarian way of doing things. So that's just what I want to add.
No, thank you. Yes, thank you. I met my students in the railway station. I can tell you that actually. I'm on record to say that I couldn't meet my student in the university, and if there's any time we write our memoir of the struggle, I would say that I met my students in the railway station and to talk about the status of that day. I'm on record of that.
Already cameras are there in the railway station.
On behalf of APSC, we'd like to thank Professor Manivannan for his influential talk about the issue of guidelines in higher educational institutions. And also we'd like to thank Dr. Arvind for sharing his experience in British university systems. And we'd like to thank Professor Milind for his continuous support for conducting this event. I'd like to invite Dr. Arvind to present this book to Today is 28th September.
Thank you very much.
Bhagat Singh birthday. So he is the most influential and iconic student. He is the best example why a student has to be politicized. So he was the most influential part for the students to be continuous against the fight against the oppression from the authoritarian point of view. So we like to remember Bhagat Singh for his work and his activities in the freedom movement of India, and the most influential person to guide us against these kind of protests, against these kind of violence and all other issues for the people. Okay, thank you.